Welcome to part three of our guide on painting the contents of the Warhammer Age of Sigmar box set. Now in this part, we're going to concentrate on what is surely the centerpiece of the entire Stormcast Eternal Army, and that is the Lord Celestant, Vandas Hammerhand. Now, if you've been following along so far, at this point, you'll have a really good idea on how to paint a Stormcast Eternal Warrior, and a large part of the Lord Celestant is no different. However, he is, of course, on the back of a Drakoth, so we're going to go into great detail about how to paint that, and we're still going to cover everything else in the model as well to give you a really great result. So without further ado, let's get started. Before we start doing any painting, I just want to quickly point out to you that I've actually built this model as two separate sub-assemblies. I've got the Drakoth, and I've also got the upper body of the Lord Celestant as well, who I've glued to a spare flying stand that I can hold whilst I'm painting the miniature, and I glued it with super glue so it's a brittle joint, which will make it really easy to break apart when we're ready for the final assembly. Now the reason why I've done this is just to make getting to certain parts of the miniature much easier as we're painting, and you'll find this particularly when we're doing the back of the Drakoth and also the inside of the Lord Celestant's cloak as well. Now we're going to start out by base coating the Drakoth skin using Stegadon Scale Green. Now as always, make sure the paint lid's fully closed and that you give it a good shake before you use each colour. And I'm going to apply this using my large base brush, because for this early stage the only thing I'm bothered about is painting the Drakoth's flesh, so all the other details don't matter at all, so it can be a bit messy. But I am still, however, going to use my palette to load up some paint. I'm going to add just a little bit of water to it. You don't need very much, just enough to thin the paint down so that it goes a bit further, dries smoother, and also will help prevent clogging up any detail. So get some loaded on your brush, and then all you got to do is just start painting this on the Drakoth skin. And like I say, it can be quite rough as you work it in there. Just make sure you get it in amongst all the scales, and they work it into all the little details all around it. And I'm going to apply two thin coats of this colour so that I get a nice strong finish, whilst also keeping the detail nice and sharp. With the base paint of Stegadon Scale Green applied, we're now ready to add some shade. And the shade we're going to use first of all is Norn Oil. Now this I'm going to apply with my medium shade brush, because you want to put on plenty, but not so much that you're completely swamping the miniature. So I'm going to get a good amount loaded on my palette. There we go. And load up plenty on your brush and start painting this onto all the areas of skin that you can see. So we've got this part around here. I'm just going to start applying this and let it settle nicely in all the cracks between the scales and also the wrinkles in the skin as well. And once you apply this all over the flesh, give it plenty of time to dry, about 40 minutes will be fine. The shade is now fully dry and we're ready for the next step, which is to begin to highlight the skin. And skin as textured as this is perfect for the dry brushing technique. So to do this, what you need is a small dry brush, and the colour I'm going to use for this is Rust Grey. Now to do the dry brushing technique, you need to get hold of some tissue and load up a small amount of paint on your brush, you don't need very much, and use the tissue to work it in amongst the bristles and to get rid of excess paint. And you don't want very much paint left on your brush before you start putting it on the miniature. In fact, you kind of want your brush to be looking like that, really. And all you do is get your miniature and just very lightly start running this over the texture of the skin. And you see straight away it catches all the sharper edges and gives us a really nice effect. Now you want to do it on the scales and also the softer flesh, which is generally on the underneath of the Drakoth and down the bottom of his legs too. And just spend a bit more time on these softer parts so that you get a slightly lighter colour on these areas. You can see I'm just taking a bit more time over the foot down here. Just take your time now and do this all over the skin. And with the dry brush of Rust Grey done, the next thing to do is to dry brush it again, but this time with Fenrisian Grey, and this time a little bit more focus about where exactly we're going to put it. So I'm still using a small dry brush for this and still getting the paint ready in the same way. Make sure you've got very little of this on your brush. And when you start applying this to the miniature, you just want to focus it more towards the softer areas of skin mostly. So for example, on the leg here, I'm going to focus it more towards the lower parts down here, but also do very small parts on the sharper details where the scales are. So I'm looking at things like the knee, for example, and I'm only going to do a very small amount there so as not to make the colour too light. I've finished applying the second dry brush now to the Drakoth skin, and you can see it's given us a really nice effect. And now we're ready to finish off with a few final highlights. These ones much sharper using a layer brush. I'm using my small layer brush for this, and still with Fenrisian Grey, so sticking with the same colour, but this time I'm going to be applying it much more precisely. So use your palette to get your paint ready by thinning it down with a little bit of water, and just drag your brush along and twist it like that to bring the bristles to a nice tip. You don't need very much paint on your brush, you just need to get as much control over it as you can. And what you're looking to do is to paint some thin lines following the sharper areas of the skin, which the dry brushing has helped define for us already. So for example, down here on the leg, all I'm going to do is paint this along these areas here where you can see these stronger lines, just to give these details a bit more sharpness and just to make them pop out. So you only need to do this on the softer areas of the skin. Don't worry about the scales, just areas like what I'm doing down here. And take your time with it, and it will give you a really nice effect and really make all these details pop out. And with that highlight applied, there's just one more colour left to go to finish off the Dracoth skin. And that colour is a Shabti Bone. And this is just for a very fine highlight, just in the sharpest features of the flesh. So you really don't need very much of this. So still using my small layer brush, and really I'm just going to make sure I get a nice fine tip so I've got lots of control over where I'm going to be painting this colour. And I'll show you on the face the kind of things I'm looking for because, well, it's, as I say, it's all the sharpest features. So on the front of its snout, for example, we've got this kind of like horn that it sort of goes up to at the front. So just a little bit there like that. Then at the base, just over its mouth as well. It's a small amount there. And also there's the cheekbone. That's quite a sharp part there as well. So you see doing this just really accentuates all these features. And with that highlight applied, the skin is now finished and we can concentrate on a smaller detail, which is going to be the inside of the mouth and also the eyes as well. Now to do this, we're going to be using four colours. First of all, we'll base coat the whole area by using Screamer Pink. And then we'll highlight it using Evelson Scarlet. After that, we're going to really concentrate on getting the fiery glow. So first of all, for that, we'll be using Fire Dragon Bright, and we'll finish it off with Flash Gits Yellow. So starting out Screamer Pink, I'm going to my small base brush this time for as much control as possible. And you just need to make sure you've got your paint ready so that it's completely under control. So thin it down with a little bit of water. There we go. And then just need to start applying it to these areas. Now for the eye, there's actually quite an area around the eye to paint with this colour. There's kind of this recess here where you can see there's like eyelids, so it's a bit sort of softer flesh in there. So you just need to paint in that whole area there. As for the mouth, you're really looking at the entire inside of it, going right up to the back of the jaws up here. As you're doing this part, just be really careful that you don't get this colour on the skin, but don't worry about the teeth because we're going to come back to those later. With the base coat applied, the next thing to do is to switch to your small layer brush to add a highlight of Evelson Scarlet. Now I'm looking for any sharper details for this, such as these little sinews we've got going down the mouth here. And also on the eyes, you need to be painting the eyelids too. So I've just got to do the bottom one there and top one up there as well. Now also at this stage, you need to start painting the inside of the mouth. So you need to make sure that you paint all of the tongue and also the back of the throat as well. With that highlight applied, I'm now ready to build up the fiery glow. So I'm using Fire Dragon Bright for this and my Artificer brush. And what I'm going to do is create a source of light first of all, such as the eye. So just paint a bit of that orange in there like that. And then I'm going to start building up a highlight, but on the surfaces the light would touch as it comes out from that point. So just a small amount on the lids of the eye like that. Now inside the mouth, what we're going to do is paint the entire back of the throat, but also we're going to have some of that light on the surfaces around it. So for example, looking at painting the middle of the tongue with this colour like that, and also the inside edges of the mouth. So what I'm going to do is just turn the model like this and just gently paint a small amount of this colour just on the edge there, just to give the hint of the light on the side of the mouth there. And then finish the effect with a small amount of Flash Gits Yellow just in the very centre of the eye. Just keep your hands as steady as you can to paint this part in. And then on the mouth, just painting the inside edge just along there, and also the back middle of the tongue and also the very back of the throat as well. And there we are. With the inside of the mouth painted, we've now finished a large part of the Dracoth. And the next thing we're going to start painting is the armour, which of course is on the Lord Celestine's upper body as well. And that's what I'm going to focus on as I show you how to paint it. But be aware there is armour on the Dracoth as well, which we'll paint at the same time in the same way. Now the first colour that you need for this is Retributor Armour. And I'm going to apply this to the Lord Celestine's body using my large base brush because, well, this is the only colour on him so far. But be aware on the Dracoth, the detail is a little bit more intricate, so you'll want to switch to a smaller brush for that. A medium base brush will be fine for that. But for this first step, all you need to do is start applying Retributor Armour all over the miniature and really work it into all the little details as you go along. And be aware that you will need to apply two thin coats of this colour to build up to a nice strong gold, which we can then work from with the next colour. Once you've finished base coating with Retributor Armour, the next thing to do is to add some shade. And we're going to use Reichlin Flesh Shade for all of the armour. And, well, on the Lord Celestine's body, I'm going to apply this using my large shade brush because it is the only colour on so far, so I want to paint all of it with this. However, this brush is obviously too large to use on the Dracoth's armour. So, well, don't use this brush on that because you'll ruin the skin that you finished so far and you really don't want to do that. Switch to your medium shade brush when you're doing that then to keep control of it. But all we're going to do is start applying this all over the armour that we've painted so far. So I'm really going to make sure I work it into all the little details so it's settling nicely. Be sure not to put on too much though, because you don't want it to start pooling. In particular, keep an eye on that towards the bottom of the miniature. And once you've finished applying this all over, give it about 40 minutes to dry. The Reichland flesh shade is now fully dry, and you can see it's settled nicely in all those recesses and really defined all the details. And what we're ready to do now is to start layering the armour using Auric Armour Gold, and this is what's going to really bring it up to that lovely shine. I'm going to use my medium layer brush for this, and I'm going to make sure I use the palette here to get as much control over the paint as possible. So thin it down a little bit and make sure, as before, we've not got too much paint on the brush by just twisting it like that, and then start applying this onto the armour panels. And I'll start on the chest armour on here, I think. And what I'm going to do is start looking for areas where the shade is settled and just going to avoid those parts. So we've got this quite flat armour plate just there, and you can see directly beneath it we've got some shade settled, so I'm going to avoid that and start painting this plate down here like that. There we go, and the same will be true further down here, just avoid the shade and start painting on there. Like that. So what you need to do now is carry on doing this all over the armour on both the Lord Celestant and the Drakoth, and this is what's going to give you that really lovely shine. I've finished applying the layer of Auric Armour Gold now, and you can see what a really nice shine it's given to all those armour panels. But we're actually going to leave the gold for the time being and start base coating some other colours onto these two sub-assemblies. And we're going to start out with the blue using Cantor Blue, and this will be for all things like the back of the cloak and the reins, and also some bits of the armour as well. And then we'll use Abaddon Black to base coat all the soft joints in the armour, and also any leather parts like straps that you can find as well. After that, we're going to use Lead Belcher for the hammerhead and also any chain parts, and then we'll use Screamer Pink to paint the actual haft of the hammer. And finally, we'll use Celestra Grey to base coat the inside of the cloak and any of the little details that later on are going to be white, so little lightning icons, for example. But starting out with Cantor Blue, I'm going to apply this to begin with using my medium base brush, because I'm actually going to start out on the back of the cloak. And this is a really large area, so it makes sense to use a larger brush for this. But be aware that the other blue parts are much smaller, so you will want to switch to a small base brush for those parts. But as I say, I'm just going to start on the back of the cloak, just base coating this on, and just being really careful whenever I get close to the gold. And also, I recommend applying two thin coats of this colour. Once you're finished with the Cantor Blue, the next base colour is Abaddon Black. Now this is for all the softer joints in the armour, such as up here, but also all the leather straps, and there are quite a lot of those on the Drakoth, so be sure to look carefully around that model just to make sure that you get them all. Next, base coat all the parts that you want to be silver using Lead Belcher. So this will be the hammerhead, but also any little chain links, and don't forget to do the stirrups as well. Next, base coat the haft of the hammer with Screamer Pink, and you will need two thin coats of this colour, and just be really careful around the hand. And finally, base coat all the parts that are going to be white using Celestra Grey. So we've got the inside of the cloak, and whilst you're doing this part, just be really careful around these little gold designs that are in the corners. So you can see I'm just taking my time working in amongst that detail there. But also we've got lots of little trinkets as well, and little lightning bolt designs, such as the ones on here, and once again, just be really careful as you paint these details in. And also, we have the Lord Celestant's hair, and there's a small amount coming out from under his helmet, and this is also base coated with Celestra Grey, and you will need to apply two thin coats of this colour. And with those five base colours now applied, we're ready to add some shade to them. And we're going to be using Norn Oil for these colours. And I'm going to apply it using my medium shade brush, because we need to keep this under control. We only want it on these new colours. So I'm just going to get some ready, use the palette to help control exactly how much of it's on my brush. And get some ready. And as I say, I'm just going to start painting this onto these five new colours. So I'm going to start up here on the cloak. And as you put this on, once again, just be really careful as you get close to the gold and also the skin of the Drakoth when you're doing that. Like that. Now, just be aware as well, when you're doing this part, you don't need to shade all of the inside of the cloak, because we want to keep it quite light for later on. Instead, just put the shade in the very deepest recesses, such as this one running down there. I've given the shade plenty of time to dry, and you can see it's settled nicely in all the recesses of those colours. And now we're going to add a few more base colours. In fact, we're going to be adding two. First of all, Zandri Dust, and this is going to be for the parchment on the Lord Celestant. On the Drakoth, it'll be for the teeth, the horns, and the claws. And then we're going to use Mephiston Red. On the Lord Celestant, this will be for his crest. On the Drakoth, it'll be for the saddle cloth. But starting out with Zandri Dust, I'm going back to my small base brush to apply this. And, well, you just need to get this ready in the same kind of way we've been doing, by adding a little bit of water in there, just to help it flow a bit smoother. There we go, that's about right. and make sure you don't have too much on your brush, and then just start applying it. And I'm going to start on the parchment that we've got up here on the back of the hammer, and just need to be really careful as you're painting this in now to avoid all those other colours that we've done so far. And also, you'll still need to apply two thin coats of this colour to build it to a nice strong coat. Once you've finished with Zandri Dust, the next base colour to apply is Mephiston Red. Now this is for the helmet crest and also the saddle cloth, and you'll need to apply, again, two thin coats of this colour. Now whilst you're doing it on the crest, be really careful because of these gold lightning bolt designs that are mixed in with the hair. So just take your time and be as neat as you can as you paint around them. Now that those two base colours are applied, we're ready to shade them as well. And the method here is going to be exactly the same as when we were shading with Norn Oil earlier on, only this time we're going to use Agrax Earthshade instead. But still with the medium shade brush for this, because once again, we want to apply enough on the miniature that it settles nicely in the recesses, but not so much that we lose control of it. So use your palette to control how much is on your brush, and then just start painting this onto all the Mephiston Red parts and all the Zandri Dust parts. So I'm going to start on this parchment here, and remember when you're doing the parchment, just make sure that the shade settles nicely in all those runes. The Agrax Earthshade is now fully dry, and we're ready to brighten up some of the colours before we begin to highlight. Now we're going to start out by reapplying Cantor Blue to all the blue parts, so the back of the cloak for example, and then we're going to do the same for Screamer Pink on the haft of the hammer. Then on the inside of the cloak we're going to reapply Celestra Grey. This is to neaten it up after the shade that we did earlier on, and then we'll begin to layer, first of all with Othuan Grey on the inside of the cloak, and then finally with Shabti Bone and all the bone coloured parts, so like the claws and the parchment for example. But starting out with Cantor Blue, I'm going to use my medium layer brush this time, and I'm going to once again use my palette to help control the paint, so mix in a bit of water, and then just twist my brush to a nice tip like that. And I'm going to start on the Lord Celestant here. What I'm going to do is look for all the blue parts and only paint this Cantor Blue on the areas where the shade has not settled so much. So for example, I'm going to be painting it here, then I'm going to leave that recess just there and then paint on the other side of it like that, just to really keep that definition that the shade gave us earlier. Next, reapply Screamer Pink to the haft of the hammer and make sure you don't have very much paint on your brush and that you just run it really lightly across it so that the paint just catches the raised detail and leaves a shade in the recesses. Now I'm just going to quickly reapply some Celestra Grey on the inside of the cloak, and this is the only area you really need to do this, it's just to neaten up where that shade was placed earlier on. So you see, all I'm going to do is paint this on, just leaving that shade in the very deepest recess, and to get a nice smooth line in between where the shade is and where the Celestra Grey is. With the inside of the cloak now neatened up, I'm going to start layering it using Althorn Grey. Now this is for the inside of the cloak only, and really what I'm going to do is use this colour to bridge between the Celestra Grey and the White Scar, which we'll add later on. So you can see I'm painting over the whole thing really, and I've got a nice smooth thin coat here. The only areas I'm going to avoid are in these deeper recessed areas down here, such as that crease we've got at the very bottom there. I'm just going to avoid that and leave some Celestra Grey showing through. And then finally, add a layer of a Shabti Bone. Now on the Lord Celestant, this is going to be on the parchment. And for this, you want to just be really careful to avoid all of those runes, and you will need to apply two thin coats to build up to a nice strong colour. And on the Drakoth, we need to layer a Shabti Bone on the teeth, horns and claws. And to do this, what I'm going to do is just paint down from the tip like this, just bring it down to a nice point partway down the horn, about two-thirds of the way down. And with those colours brightened up, all that's left to do is to highlight the model. And we're going to start by highlighting all of the gold armour. And the colour we need to do this is Liberator Gold. Now this is going to be very much like right at the start of this video when we were highlighting the Drakoth skin. And I've got to make sure I use the palette to get the paint to be flowing easily and to have a nice tip on the brush. So you can add a little bit of water to it, you don't need very much, just so that it flows easily. And you can always test it on the palette by just running your brush along like that and twisting it and just making sure it's flowing nicely. There we go. So what we want to do now is start painting this on all the sharper details of the gold armour. So if I start on the Lord Celestant's body here, on this plate we've got down here, I'm going to look for all these sharper corners such as along there, and in fact with these very defined corners, you can even use the side of your brush, just run it along like that to get a nice sharp line very quickly. Other times you will just need to keep your hand as steady as possible, such as on this lightning bolt, and I'm just going to very briefly go around the edge like that. And doing this just really starts to really bring out a beautiful shine on that armour. Now this step will probably be the longest stage of painting the entire miniature, but it really is worth doing and taking your time with because the effect is really nice. And you do it in exactly the same way on the Drakoth's armour as well. I've finished highlighting now with Liberator Gold, and you can see what an effect it's had on all of those gold panels. And now what we're going to do is highlight all the blue parts. And for this, the colour I'm going to use is Teclis Blue. And the technique is going to be, well, just the same as what we used on the gold. So still with my small layer brush, I'm once again going to use my palette to make sure my paint's flowing easily by adding a bit of water and get that good tip on the brush. And then once again, you're looking for all the sharper details, but on the blue parts this time. So I'm going to start on the cloak here of the Lord Celestant, and I'm just looking for the sharper folds on that cloak. So along there, for example, I'm just going to paint a thin blue line just following that raised part like that. And with the blue complete, we're now ready to highlight the remaining few colours. And we're going to start out with the red. And for this, we'll be using Evilsun Scarlet. So this will be things like the helmet crest and also the saddle cloth. And then we'll use Eshin Grey to highlight all the black parts, so things like the leather straps. Then we're going to use Runefang Steel for all the silver parts. So this will be things like the hammerhead and also any chain links. And then we'll move on to using White Scar to finish off the inside of the cloak and also to highlight any of the little white designs, like the little lightning bolts scattered around the model. Finally, we'll use Pallid Witch Flesh to finish off all of the bone and also the parchment as well. But starting out with Evilsun Scarlet for the red, I'm still using my small layer brush for this. And once again, I'm just going to make sure the paint's flowing nice and easily by using my palette. And make sure you don't get very much paint on your brush for this, because I'm going to start out with my crest on the top of the helmet here. And what I'm going to do is actually just use the side of my brush and very lightly run it along it like that, so that the paint just catches those raised hairs running down it like that. Next, highlight all the black details using Eshin Grey. And once again, you're looking for all the sharpest parts, such as either side of the strap that we've got inside the elbow joint here. With the black finished, the next area to highlight are all the silver parts using Runefang Steel. And once again, I'm looking for all the sharpest edges, such as these little decorations we've got on the head of the hammer. So they're like that, and also the sharp corners like the head of it too. But you're looking at doing this on all the other silver parts, such as the stirrups, and also the little chain links on the decorations on the Drakoth. The next colour to highlight with is White Scar, and this is going to be for the inside of the cloak where we're looking for the folds, such as this one along here. I'm just going to paint a line of this running along creases like that. Also, you can do the edge if you want to, and if you do, just be really careful so that you get a nice neat line between the white and the blue on the back, such as we're getting there. Now, as well, I'm going to be doing the little lightning bolt designs, such as the ones we've got on the chest here. And the final bit to do with this colour is his hair, which we've got some on here. And like when we were doing the helmet crest earlier, just use the side of your brush just to pick out some of these strands. And finally, highlight all the bone-coloured parts with Pallid Witch Flesh. Now on the Lord Celestant's body, that's going to be the parchment. And for this, I'm going to be painting a line of this colour just along the edges of the parchment, like along there, for example, and also on the runes as well. You don't actually have to do all the edges of the runes, just enough to give them a bit of definition so that you can see them from a distance. And on the Drakoth, we'll use Pallid Witch Flesh to finish off the teeth, horns and claws. And to do this, it's like when we applied the Shabti Bone to them earlier. I'm just going to paint some lines of this running down from the tip, and I'm going to go about a quarter of the way down, so around about to there. And well, once you've done this, all that remains to do is to make the final assembly of your model. And I do recommend you stick it together with super glue thin, and do make sure that the limbs are all lined up when you're gluing it into place. And after that, all you've got to do is base it, and I recommend you base it in the same way as the rest of your army. And there he is, the centrepiece of the Stormcast Eternal Army, the Lord Celestant Vandas Hammerhand is complete. And well, I've had loads of fun painting this miniature because it's always fun to paint a monster. But as you can see, it's really easy to get a great result by just using a few simple techniques. So always remember, whenever you're painting a more complex model like this, it's a good idea to think about sub-assemblies before you start sticking anything together, because it makes the painting process easier. And that was definitely the case with this model, especially when we were doing the inside of the cloak and also the back of the Drakoth. Now, the Drakoth is a model with lots of real good texture on the skin, which makes it ideal for dry brushing. And if you decide to dry brush yours as well, make sure you do this early on because it is a messy technique. So do it first, then neaten up as you add further colours. Now, there's also times when we used shade on this miniature in a very precise way. So when you're doing the same thing, make sure you don't put on too much at once because it's easy to lose control of it and get it onto colours where you don't want it. And finally, when you do your final assembly, I recommend you stick it together with super glue thin because the brush on it makes it really easy to control exactly how much you're putting on and where you're putting it, and you really don't need very much. So we are now complete with the Stormcast Eternal Forces, and we're ready to move on to their opponents, the Khorne Warriors of the Gortide. And we're going to start out by painting the Blood Reavers and also the Blood Stoker as well. So we'll see you in part 4, where we'll begin with those models.